So, Seishun Buta Yaroa Banigaru Senpai no Yume o Minai just finished up its first arc, and as such, I think it's a good point in time to dig into how it executed that arc. And, to spoil my own conclusion here, why what we've seen thus far is really promising. The most standout element has got to be the fantastic snappy dialogue. Even in the absence of anything else, the series is really fun to watch on a moment-to-moment basis just because of this. Anime goes for sarcastic and quippy with their characters fairly often, but rarely do those characters end up being as clever and genuinely funny as they are in this series. And I think a big part of that is because Bunny Girl nails the back-and-forth element of snappy conversation. For example, in episode 2, there's some great playful flirtation. Mai brings up sexuality to fluster Sakuta. He catches her off guard by taking it in stride and hilariously raises the stakes with the charmingly cheesy, "My thoughts are 100 times more lewd than what you're imagining." After a brief pause, she unexpectedly returns fire to take the win, though, by crossing the line of simple verbal sexual teasing to outright physical sexuality. This kind of back and forth as they each tentatively raise the stakes is really well done in its trueness to life. Thankfully, that dialogue isn't the only strength, though. One little well-done detail is the variety of hair colors and shades for the background characters. That, in conjunction with the fairly muted hair of the main characters, means there's no main character syndrome going on here, where you can pick out the main cast from a crowd just because of how much their hair stands out. And to get back to primary components of the series, it's already established interesting ideas revolving around its central mechanic, adolescence syndrome. Everything we've seen of this mysterious phenomenon right now relates back to the way broader society builds a conception of a person, and then how it views and judges them because of that construct. Kaede upsets one of the social ringleaders of her school, so they spread rumors about her and rally her classmates against her. They bully her on the internet, through her phone, and these attacks manifest as actual physical harm done to Kaede. The fact that the damage done looks pretty similar to self-harm only adds further weight to the analogy the series constructs. Our protagonist, Sakuta, is of course infamous for the hospitalization incident, a rumor that follows him around and ostracizes him. And finally, this initial arc is about how Mai's celebrity has caused issues for her. Society builds up ideas of people, divorced from those people themselves, and those ideas have real consequences. The role media generally, and especially the internet, serves to propagate this is also set up as an idea to be explored. When Mai says, "It's amazing, isn't it? All this information about one individual being out in the open like this," in regards to those rumors surrounding Sakuta. And the toxic, insidious aspect of that interconnected culture is put on full display when a girl offhandedly says, "If I don't reply quickly, they'll stop being my friends," as if that's at all a rational or right way for the world to function. It's the pressure and stress these false constructed perceptions of people can induce that caused Mai to wish to go to a world where nobody knew who I was. And so, that wish got granted. It was just too stressful having so many people know of her persona and be invested in that, without caring about her as an actual person, and this extended all the way to her own mother. As I interpret it, people forgot about her in the reverse order of how much they cared about her. Those who simply knew her as a celebrity were the first to forget. Then the owner of the shop she frequents forgot. The reporter interested in her eventually forgot, as did, tellingly, her own mother. Before all that was left was Sakuta and his two friends, who cared about Mai due to the fact that Sakuta himself was so invested in her. It's a fantastic little piece of storytelling because it lets us know that her mother does care about her, the relationship isn't entirely cynical, but that she's still somewhat distant from her own daughter. Sakuta has enough of that interest in her, is willing to make enough of an effort to get to know her on a personal level, that he's able to identify what she really wants, and make her face her own desires. The celebrity Sakurajima Mai is forgotten as a result of her wish, but the person is not, and thus Sakuta, who is the only one who really reached out to get to know her personally, is able to remember her at the end. Mai cuts off that first conversation in Sakuta's room when he shows a misunderstanding of her, saying her manager, her mom, cares about her. Sakuta wasn't really in a position where he could have been expected to know the nature of that relationship and the hang-ups Mai has about it, but she's just deeply insecure about people misunderstanding her, about people forming concepts of her in their own minds that differ from who she truly is. Mai says, "Mind your own business," but what she really means is, "Don't conjecture about me, don't construct an idea of me. me if you don't know me well enough to do so accurately. That's part of why the swimsuit debacle is so traumatizing to her, because it painted an insincere picture of the kind of person she is. She is not, in fact, totally fine with being the object of young boys' erotic fantasies, as she says she is in the first episode. The series bringing up and providing a thorough explanation of the concept of Schrödinger's cat feels a bit like the typical pretentious, nonsensical Wikipedia article recitation that so many light novel series love to indulge in.
マクガフィンって知ってるかい?マクガフィン?マクガフィンについて聞かれた。マクガフィン?マクガフィン?マクガフィンって知ってますか?
マクガフィン?
マクガフィンって何ですか?マクガフィン?マクガフィンって聞いたことない?
But I think the series puts that concept towards enough of a thematic purpose to at least mostly justify doing so. The principle of Schrödinger's cat underscores the naive flaw in Mai's wish, that flaw being that in a world where nobody knows who she is, in the world that slowly comes into being as this arc's end rolls around, she functionally doesn't exist, which puts her right back in the same problematic place that her celebrity was trapping her in, not having anyone that knew and appreciated her on a personal level. Anonymity wasn't the way to escape her problems, hence why Sakuta said she should get back into showbiz. The answer was instead to form a genuine relationship, to get close enough to someone to build that personal understanding. It's honestly a really powerful and relevant message, that we're better off going out and trying to form close relationships to help us bear the BS of the world than trying to simply withdraw entirely from that world. And I'm very excited to see where the series will go from here thematically. There's a lot of positives to the series, but where I think it does falter is in how things get solved. As I went over, it works on a thematic level. I like how Mai's need for a personal connection is explored, but Sakuta just kind of insists pretty bluntly, "I know what you want, you should go do that." He had some evidence to suspect she wanted to go back to showbiz, but it was circumstantial, and not really enough to assert it as strongly as he did. I think he deserves the slap he got here, because Mai's decision to leave was caused by the trauma she was left with as a result of her sexual exploitation as a middle schooler. She's gone through some seriously messed up stuff, and I don't think it'd be unfair or unreasonable of her to want to withdraw from show business entirely due to it. I've held back on the Monogatari comparisons that get thrown around so much in regards to this series until now, but I think that warrants discussion here. Koyomi is a bit of a subversion of the stereotypical go-around-fixing-all-the-girls'-problems light novel guy protagonist. His romantic relationship with Senjo Gahara is established very early on, so there's no will-they-won't-they, and no romantic drive as he continues to try to help those around him. There may be romantic interest, sure, but it isn't dangling an actual romance between him and those he's helping out in front of us. He's already taken. I love that Bunny Girl has done the same here. I think it's a great move. However, it fails to learn from another of the subversions that Koyomi performed, the fact that he doesn't really solve any of the girls' issues for them. Koyomi provides his support, to be sure, and in many cases does help them reach a resolution to their struggles, but in just about every case, be it Senjo in the series' first arc, Kitagi Crab, or Kanbaru later on, they have to make the personal realization, they have to accept some aspect of themselves, in order to finally overcome their hang-ups. I think this is frankly even more important than establishing the OTP early on, because by doing this, light novel guy goes from being an omnipotent savior to a grounded dude that's just stumbling along trying to do the best he can with the good intentions that he has. Probably the most unsatisfying part of what is otherwise a really solid arc is the way this exchange on the bridge goes down. Sakuta sort of just says, "No, this is what you truly want, I know that," and then insists that she should do it. It feels a bit condescending on the series' part for him to say, "Deep down, you know it too, Mai," as if she couldn't assess her own feelings as accurately as Sakuta could. And more importantly, it's just unsatisfying for this to be the solution. It's simple, and doesn't require Mai to really grow much as a character. She just has to accept what Sakuta tells her is the case about herself as true. If she'd undergone some personal growth, instead of just having to accept what he says to solve things, then an already solid arc would have been all the stronger, I think. With all that said, though, I think calling the series a Monogatari clone, or Monogatari but worse, misses the mark. This is a great, deeply entertaining series in its own right. And if it's a Monogatari clone, then so are dozens of other light novels that follow the very well-established formula of the protagonist going around helping girls with their hang-ups. Just because it's good and a bit subversive doesn't mean it's a hollow imitation. Because I think that the many immensely fun and charming scenes, like Sakuta screaming at the entire school about how much he loves Mai, are a clear indication that Bunny Girl has plenty of inspiration and heart of its own. This video ended up being a real fun time. Even after just 3 episodes, there was a lot to dig into with this series, and so I got my longest script of the month thus far. Now, unfortunately, I finished writing it this afternoon, so I only have a few hours to edit both the audio and video for it, so I'm gonna go get on that real quick here. An immense thank you to Psyker, MathWiz97, Jonathan Conley, Skylar Morrow, Tyler Monk, Tincho37, Josh Grant, Lord Liquid Bacon III, Elaine Aldfelt, David McCown, Hijort Dog, Smokeweed Sephiroth420, JMAM4747, Jedi168, Peach Plum, Chase Sutter, and everyone else on Patreon who's putting up with the credits once again not being up to date. I'm sorry.